Thanks, bro. All right, so this morning, we are going to start a new series called The Narrow Place. The Narrow Place. Look at the person next to you. Uh-oh. Say, you're going to get out of the narrow place. You're going. Come on, let's say this. Okay, let's say it together. Let's try this again. Here we go. You're going to get out of the narrow place. So this morning we are going to start this new series, and I want to welcome those watching on Facebook Live. I always forget that part. Welcome to watching us. Just a little like awesome thing, guys. Our last week's post was viewed by over 11,000 people. Wow. Yeah. I was like, shoot, I got to get on a diet. Anyways. Okay, so so I wanted to shout out to those watching online. Hope you'll check out our church website and Facebook page as well. So we're going to start this new series called The Narrow Place. And I want to start by just telling you something that happened in my life a few years ago that triggered the idea for the series. I was living in Michigan at the time, and I was working at our church and doing what you do when you're on low budget ministry. And that's called work what you got till you get what you want. Work what you want to get what you need. You just got to work what you got. And so we were trying to build a backdrop in our kids area at the church, but we didn't have any budgets for it. And so we decided to build this wall out of PVC pipe, which we had done in the past. So like that black wall back there, it'd be like if that wasn't boards and stuff, like it would just be out of PVC pipe because it's cheap. PVC pipe, I learned. If you could build houses out of PVC pipe, you could like save a lot of money. And so we got PVC pipe and we got some material. And my buddy TJ and I were standing on folding chairs because, we're real resourceful. And so they were kind of like teetering like this as you've got this thing above your head and you're trying to connect the PVC pipe. And all I remember is trying to connect the pipe and then get the duct tape around it so it wouldn't fall down and hurt a kid because it's a kid's area. But before I got the duct tape around it, I remember connecting it. And then the next thing I remember was just like some birdies like tweet, 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 tweet. And I remember it being black. And then I opened my eyes and I was like, oh. Something just happened, and the PVC pipe literally was like 3 feet above me. Something came undone, and it cracked me like right on the head, like boom. And I was like, oh, okay. So I came kind of out of the tweet mode of the little every black. It was kind of dark around me, and I was like, I think I just like. And teacher's like, are you okay? And I was like, oh yeah, I'm good. I'm good. Everything's great. And so I drove myself home because I'm good. And my wife's a nurse, so I figured, what's the worst thing? I die in my sleep. She'll revive me because she's a nurse. And so I go home, and Kelsey's at work. And when I get home, I started having this terrible headache, just terrible. And I was like, what is going on? And so I'm texting her at work. And you know, when you're married to a nurse, there's one of two things happen. Either you get no sympathy at all, or you're gonna die. You understand? If you got a cold, it's like, get over it. I'm like, I just want to lay here and relax because I don't feel good. And she's like, do you want me to talk to you about not feeling good? This lady that I was with this week that died. Okay, fine. All right. So, but sometimes when she's at work and I text her and it could be bad, she starts asking people and then it gets worse. And so by the time I decided it was time to go to the hospital, we basically had decided that I had an internal brain bleed and that if I didn't get to the hospital within 3 hours, I was going to die. And so I drive myself, which is really wise, over to the emergency room and I go in and they say, what's wrong? And I say, I got conked in the head with a PVC pipe and I think I'm going to die. I think there's an internal bleed. I have a headache. Please help me. And so they put me on this gurney in the ER, and they didn't even give me a room. Like, what am I paying for? They put me in the hallway because they were overbooked. Whatever that's about. The bill sure didn't say overbooked hallway room, but anyways. And so they put me on the gurney, and they say, we're going to take you in for a CAT scan. Now, I've had CAT scans before, fed MRIs, had PET scans, all those scan things they do and different things. They've been trying for a long time to figure out what's going on up here, and no one knows. And so they take me in for the CAT scan, and for some reason, 2 years ago, I don't know what happened inside of me, but I used to go get a CAT scan when I was younger because I've fell a few times, had some concussions, and I was fine. Maybe it's because I'm older, but they put me back in that tube, and I am claustrophobic, and I did not know it. And I started like, help, 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 and the lady's like, what is going on, sir? And I'm like, I'm going to die. I'm a little overly dramatic, so I'm not actually over-dramatizing this. This is actually how I live. And I'm like, I'm going to die. And she's like, sir, it's going to be okay. Shut your eyes. And so I'm shutting my eyes, and I'm like, please, Jesus, I don't want to die. Na, 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 na. Like, just trying to make noise. And the thing is going around my head, and I was just like, And in that moment, this is not a lie, I thought I could preach on this. Because we were not created to be in small places. We were not created to stay in small little places where we feel claustrophobic and tied down and stuck. We were created to soar. We were created to fly. We were created to go into big, wide, open spaces. And that's why in your life right now, if you feel like you're in a narrow place, you're in a small little spot, you feel like you're gonna die. Maybe not physically, but emotionally or spiritually, you feel so confined to the space you're in.
I just had one Wednesday.
For those of you that didn't hear, she said, you're only in there for a few seconds. It's not that bad. Hey, look, I'm a little dramatic. I know. I'm sorry. I understand. I should not have been that way, but I needed a good illustration. But I really did freak out like that. Okay, so anyways, you're not created for small. So I found this out recently, and I think this is one of the craziest things I never knew. I've been in church my entire life, and I never knew what the original Hebrew word was for Egypt. If you know anything about Egypt, and we're going to talk this morning about Joseph in the Old Testament. In fact, if you got your Bible, you can turn over to the book of Genesis. We're not going to read the whole Joseph story because it's like 12 chapters. But if you want to flip through as I'm telling some of the story, you're welcome to do that. It basically starts around Genesis 38 to 40 and goes to the end of the book of Genesis. But Joseph was a guy who was, through the course of his life, saw a lot of narrow spaces. Joseph's story starts out with him being the favorite child in his family. Any favorite childs here? Anyone who thinks of the favorite child? Anyone have a favorite child? You can't. I have an only child, so I can say that, right? Okay, so Jacob, Joseph's father, has 12 kids, which that's, whew. I don't know what was going on back in Israel, but something, they needed some TV or something. So they had 12 kids. That was for free. So 12 kids, and Joseph is his second to last kid. And something about Joseph, well, here's the reason why Jacob loved Joseph so much more than his others, was that Jacob's story was he had this woman that he wanted really bad, and he wanted to marry her. And at that time, he had to negotiate with the father-in-law. This is the DJ translation. He had to negotiate with the father-in-law for the wife. And so he said, if you work for me 7 years, I'll give you Rachel, the girl he wanted. So Jacob worked for him 7 years. Work for anybody else feel that? 7 years? I love my wife, but 7 years? Oh, Lord. And so work for him 7 years, and they get to the ceremony, and I don't understand all this, but it's the Bible, and they do the whole ceremony, and they go into the tent to do what you do, and the next morning, he finds out it wasn't the right woman. The next morning. It was dark. Anyway, so what does he do? Instead of being like, oh, I guess I got this woman and I'll work out my life and I'll just take what I've got and make it work, you know? No. I am going to go work 7 more years to get the next wife. And so 7 years later, so 14 years now, this guy has worked to get Rachel. And he finally gets Rachel, and Rachel bears him a son, and the son is Joseph. And so Jacob loves Joseph, the Bible says, more than all the others. And here's the thing, parents, if you love one of your kids more than the others, don't tell the others. Okay? The guy makes him a coat. I mean, he like gives him more food. He gives him double portions of everything. So all other 10 brothers of the time are watching this going, what in the world is dad doing with this guy? And I don't know about you, but if you've ever been in a situation where you're the one who's not favored, sometimes you get a little annoyed with those around you who are. And you're just like, I'm kind of getting sick of this. And so Joseph has a dream one night. And because he's the favorite child and he's very open about it and his dad has told him he's the favorite child, he loves to share that with his siblings as well. And so he has a dream one night. And in the dream, his siblings are all bowing down, isn't that the dream, to him. They're all they're just bowing down to their brother. And so he comes out the next morning to breakfast and lets the family know, hey, I had a dream. And in my dream, you all were bowing down to me. As if the coat wasn't enough. And so the brothers at this point are like, we have had it with our brother. They go out to tend sheep. This is the fast, you know, that was like three chapters right there. They go out to tend sheep. And they, as they're out there, the father says to Joseph, why don't you go out and take your brothers some food? Because they'll get hungry as they're tending the sheep out there. And so Joseph takes food out to the brothers. And when he comes to them, they say, oh, here comes the favored one. Here comes dad's favorite. Here comes the guy who thinks he's the greatest. Let's put an end to this right now. And Joseph comes, and his own brothers attack him and put him in a pit with the mindset or the thought that they were going to kill him. But his one brother, Reuben, says, no, we can't kill our brother. And so about that time, these travelers were coming en route to Egypt, and they said, why don't we instead sell him to the Egyptians, and he can be their slave? And so they take their brother out of the pit and sell him into slavery in Egypt. And Joseph now is sent to Egypt, and at first he's put in jail, and everywhere he goes, everywhere that Joseph goes, here's the thing about favor. When you got favor on you, it doesn't matter where you go, you will succeed. You can be in a penthouse and be like, yeah, or you can be in a pit. You may not feel like, yeah, but God's favor is still on you. And so Joseph gets to Egypt, and Potiphar begins to see what he has done. Potiphar would have been like governor of the place he lived. And so he goes and he sees what Joseph is already doing as he's there. And he says, I want to bring you into my own house, and I want to promote you, and I want you to lead all the servants in my house. And now this guy who was in a pit and then was a slave has now become the person in charge of Potiphar's house. And the story could end there, and it still is pretty bad because he was thrown into a pit and he was sold into slavery, but it continues. And as he is in Potiphar's house, serving his house and being faithful and doing what he knew to do and being the way God told him to be, Potiphar's wife takes to looking at him and thinks, I need some of that. That's a DJV. I need some of that. And so one day, she pulls Joseph aside and tries to entice him. And Joseph, because he was a man of integrity and a man of character, come on, guys. When some woman who's not your wife is trying to entice you, lets her keep the clothes and runs as far as he can. I could save some marriages this morning if some of y'all just start running. Run from that computer screen. Can you hear me? Run from that coworker who's trying to make you feel good because you feel like at home she just doesn't value me. Don't get me going there this morning. All right, so, but instead, he could have, right? And the Bible wouldn't have changed, I don't think. There still would have been more. But he could have said, okay, I'll come with you because she's my master and my master's telling me something to do. Don't ever do something wrong for the sake of someone else. Your integrity is more important than what people think of you. I had a job one time where I had a boss who said to me, I need you to do this. And I said, but that's not legal, because I worked in an industry where things were legal and not legal. Well, I guess we all do. There's always legal and not legal. But, and she said, I need you to do this. And I said, I can't. And she said, well, then this situation is not going to close, and this deal is not going to go through. And I said, I'm sorry, I can't do it because it's not legal. And she said, well, you have to. And I said, well, then you just need to fire me because I can't do it. I can't jeopardize my integrity for what you think of me, knowing that God always has better ahead of me. And if I mess it up right here because I give in to what you think, then I'll never see what God has in front of me. Because every narrow place you're in, every place you feel claustrophobic in your life right now is developing you and testing you for where you're going. So don't give in to those who say to you, oh, it's just, that's a gray area. It's just a gray area. It doesn't really matter. What matters is God's looking at your heart. And God is watching and he's saying, yeah, that guy's got integrity. He's got character. And so Joseph runs away. And so because Potiphar's wife, which, you know, you probably would, freaks out and like, oh, shoot, what am I going to tell my husband? Look, he came in and he tried to take advantage of me and I threw him out. And so I got a piece of his garment as he ran. And so Potiphar believes his wife and goes out and sends Joseph back to prison again. This guy has been in Egypt now for years and been in prison twice, been a slave, been a servant. This is not the favored child who's wearing the robe and telling his family they're going to bow down to him. This guy is in a narrow place. And so Joseph gets into prison. But because he had integrity and because he had character, God's favor was still on him. And so even in prison, once again, this guy becomes first in command of the prison. The prison guard says, you help lead this prison. And one night as Joseph's in the prison, there's this a baker and a, I don't remember the other guy. There's two guys anyways. That's really bad. Sorry. Okay, so one of the guys is the baker and the other guy is a cupbearer. Thank you. That's the word, cupbearer to the king. So these two guys have a dream. It's interesting, all these things in Joseph's life that correlate different things. When Joseph had a dream, he had two dreams. Now these two guys have two dreams. And they tell Joseph about the dreams, and through a series of events, Joseph interprets these dreams for them. And he tells the one guy, within 3 days, you are going to be restored, and you're going to go back to Pharaoh, the king of Egypt, and he is going to give you back your job. And when you do, tell him not to forget about me. Because I'm in this prison, and I wasn't created for this small place. I wasn't created to be claustrophobic. I was created to soar, and I'm stuck in this prison. So if you could put a good word in for me to Pharaoh, I'd appreciate it. Okay. The baker, hate to break it to you, bud, but in 3 days, Pharaoh's going to have your head. That's a sad day. And so 3 days later, they come in, they take the baker, they behead him, they take the cupbearer, and they put him back in Pharaoh's house, but he forgets to tell them about Joseph, which is interesting in our lives, how many people we could help them prosper, but we don't think about it. There's that person that we could stop and we could help, and one thing for us that wouldn't even be hard, right? Sure, I can give that person $5. Sure, I can fill their gas tank up. Sure, I can see that lady on the side of the road that needs help changing a tire, but I got places to go and people to see, right? One little thing would have changed another few years, but a few more years go by, and he forgot. And one night, Pharaoh has two dreams. And Pharaoh begins to tell all his advisors and the wise people around him about his dreams, and he says, I don't know what's going on. And the cupbearer goes, oh, I forgot. There was this guy when I was in prison, and he told me I'd be restored back here, and you should call him. And so they go on and get Joseph, and they bring him into Pharaoh's house, and he interprets Pharaoh's dreams. And Pharaoh's part of the dream he interprets is that Israel, or Egypt, will have 7 years of great prosperity and then 7 years of famine. And what God is telling Pharaoh is that in the 7 years of prosperity, if you don't save up for the years of famine, you guys are going to die. And so Pharaoh hears this, and he goes, okay, I need you to run this program for me. The guy was in prison. When's the last time we went down to Grant County to grab the next employee for our business? We're like, I don't know. We got to get them on programs. We got to give grace to everyone because you don't know why they're there and you don't know what they did, but you know that this is not over for them. And so Pharaoh takes the guy and takes Joseph, and he makes him second in command of all of Egypt. Second in command of all of Egypt. A few years go by, the 7 years of prosperity and its abundance, and this guy is now back to living like a king, and he's got robes that would make his robe his dad gave him look just shameful, and he's got palaces, and he's got a wife, and he's got kids, and life is amazing. And then 7 years later, famine hits. But because they had stored up, they had all the wealth that they needed to supply for everyone that came to Egypt. And so people began to come to Egypt. And one day, his family shows back up. Those brothers that had thrown him into a pit and sold him into slavery show back up at his door. And they come in to his palace, and they ask for food from him, and they bow down to this ruler who happens to be their brother that they sold into slavery. And they say, "We've come for food." And it's a long story that you could preach for days, honestly. I don't have time this morning to go through all the things that happened with his brothers. But long story short, he ends up moving his entire family back to Egypt and prospers his family greater than they ever had been prospered before, and ends up being restored back to his father. Because he didn't give up when he was in the small places. So I found out a couple weeks ago, and I got like, "Woo, I know what we're going to name this series." Anybody else? Okay, I know y'all aren't preachers, so you probably don't get as excited when you find things out. But listen to this. There's a word in Hebrew and Aramaic called, I'm gonna botch the word, but it's Mizraim. Mizraim. And that is the Hebrew translation for Egypt, for the nation of Egypt. But there's two translations to that word. Mizraim means Egypt, but it also means boundaries, limits, restrictions, or the narrow place. And I heard that a few weeks ago, and I was like, oh. Because if you know Bible at all, and you know what goes on in Egypt generation after generation of slavery and bondage and all these things that are constantly holding people back from what God has for them, you know that that is a great translation of what a word should mean for a country that was so about taking advantage of people, and people were constantly trying to get free. So much of the translation of the name of the country actually was what it was, but not on purpose. It was the narrow place. And so over the course of the next few weeks, we are going to look at Egypt and look at the book of Exodus and look at people that came through the narrow place into the wide open spaces in their life. Joseph had to endure a lot to get to where he went to. If you're taking notes this morning, a couple things you can write down is that Joseph had to endure a lot of suffering to get to where he needed to go. He had to endure a lot of suffering. You know, we don't like to talk much about suffering. Anybody else? I don't want to suffer, right? I prefer to not suffer. And some suffering I think we put on ourselves, and we suffer because we make our own, you know, you make your own bed and you lie in it, and that kind of suffering. But some things you have to go through because they're developing you for where you're heading. And suffering gives us a bigger perspective for how we can see things from God's point of view. And so when you look at those narrow places in your life and the things that you've been through, the places that you've gone that you didn't want to go, and the situations you've dealt with that you didn't want to deal with, that is suffering, and it does hurt. But know that God is never trying to hurt you. God is trying to prepare you to get you out of the narrow place and into a place where you can soar. I heard this week about a guy named Viktor Frankl. Viktor was a survivor of the Holocaust, and was a psychiatrist that lived in the early 1900s. And this guy one day was writing about his experience as part of the Holocaust. And I'll read you what he said. He said, "One day, a few days after the liberation, I walked through the country past flowering meadows. For miles and miles towards the market town near the camp, larks rose to the sky and I could hear their joyous song. There was no one to be seen for miles around, nothing but the wide earth and sky and larks' jubilation and the freedom of space. I stopped, looked around and up to the sky, and then I went down to my knees. At that moment, there was very little I knew of myself or of the world, but I had one sentence in mind. Always the same. I called to the Lord from my narrow prison, and he answered me in the freedom of space. How long I knelt there and repeated the sentence, memory can no longer recall. But I know that one day in that hour, My new life started. Step for step, I progressed until again I became a human being. His suffering, yeah. His suffering in the narrow place led him to a wide open space. I don't know what you're going through in your life right now that might feel a little bit confined. You might feel like I felt in that CAT scan that was 20 seconds long that felt like it was 20 years. You might feel like you're going through stuff in your life that you're like, I cannot handle the pain of what I'm experiencing. But I want you to know today that God did not create you for that pain, but he allows some of that narrowness to come through to develop you into the person that he needs you to be to impact the world in greater ways. If Joseph had not been put in prison, if Joseph had not gone to the pit, he would never have seen the palace, because the pit is preparing you for the palace. And see, some of us in our instant gratification culture want to just get to the palace in whatever aspect of life we're talking about. We just want it now, and we got to get there, and it's going to be great, and everything's going to be wonderful, and we're not going to have any issues. And God's like, if I were to give you right now what you want, you couldn't handle it. And so I'm letting you be developed and go through the life you're going so you can come out stronger and able to handle everything that I have for you. The narrow place is not where you will stay. But how you respond in it will determine how long you stay there. Joseph did it right. He had integrity. He had character. When he's put in prison, he continues to serve. He continues to do what he knows to do. But so many times what happens to us is we get into a pit in our life, and all we do is start marching around our pit, talking about how bad our pit is. Oh, my pit's so bad, and mama's pit was bad, and grandma's pit was bad, and great-grandma's pit was bad, and our whole family's under a curse, and this stupid, stinking pit. And God's like, then get out! Because the way out of the pit is your intention, your character, your integrity. You're not going to get out of the circumstance talking about the circumstance and how bad the circumstance is. You're going to get out by declaring that God is good, that he is for you, that your best days are ahead of you, and in the process, serving like you will when you get to the palace. Because if you get to the palace and you haven't gone through the pit, you're going to be arrogant. Nothing. No empathy. No compassion. When I started in ministry and realized I had a call of ministry on my life, I just thought I'd wake up the next day and be popular, you know? Have a TV ministry. All those lights, you know, and cameras. I thought someone, you know, the chauffeur would come pick me up, take me to my conference. Right? I wouldn't trade the things I've had to go through to get even to this spot, and I don't believe that this is where we're staying. I think there's still a whole lot more ahead of us, right? But I wouldn't trade the 10 years of what I've had to go through to get to where I am today, because I'm telling you what, when I look at someone now, I have a whole lot more compassion than I would have 10 years ago. Because I can empathize with your pain because I've had to endure some myself. When you come to me and talk about losing a job, I know what it feels like because I've lost jobs. When you come to me and talk about losing relationships, I've lost relationships. I've had people call me crazy. I've had people tell me I can't, even you'll never get to where you want to be. I've all the stuff that people are going to say, right? But if I had just woke up one day and God's like, here you go. Your story means nothing without the story. A lot of us want to get up and share our story of all our glory, but if you don't have story, you will have no glory. And you don't just get to the glory without experiencing some of the story. So how are you going to respond in your pit? As we wrap up this morning, there's a few things you can write down that'll come up on the screen as well. First thing to write down about the narrow place is that what the enemy meant for evil, God can use for good. I love the verse in Genesis chapter 50, verse 20. Joseph is talking to his brothers when they come back and they say, Joseph, forgive us. We're so sorry for putting you in the pit. And Joseph says, you intended to harm me, but God intended it for good to accomplish what is now being done, the saving of many lives. You intended to harm me, but God intended it for good. And the good that God intends it for is not just for you to feel good. It's for the saving of many lives. Psalm 118:5 said, when I was hard pressed, I cried to the Lord, and he brought me in to a spacious place. What the enemy meant for evil, God can use for your good. The next one to write down is that out of the narrow place can come abundant blessing when God is in it. If Joseph had not had to live in that pit, Egypt would not, listen to this, Egypt would not have had the blessing of getting to prosper the rest of the world. Because if Joseph hadn't interpreted Pharaoh's dreams, he never would have been put in the place to remind Pharaoh to save up for the hard days ahead. And so out of his claustrophobia, out of that small place, out of the narrow place, God brought abundant blessing. Don't throw in the towel where you're at right now. Do not give up on God right now. I watch so many people give up on God right before he's about to break through. I've been parts of ministries where people have walked away because it's too hard and I can't endure and I can't go through it and I just can't deal with what's coming against me. And they walk away and a month later, the very breakthrough they've been praying for finally comes through. Don't throw in the towel before it's time to get to where you need to go. God's got you in the palm of his hand. He's never going to leave you. He's never going to forsake you. He's never going to give up on you. He says that I will be with you when you go through the fires. Why? Not because God wants to burn you. Because God knows that sometimes life throws things at you that you have to overcome, and it's hard to stay faithful, and it's hard to keep your integrity, and it's hard to keep your character. But when you do, you will come into abundant blessing. The last one to write down is that what God tells you will come to pass no matter what happens in between. What God tells you will come to pass no matter what happens in between. This week I was having a hard time falling asleep. And so I was laying in bed and Kelsey was already asleep next to me, and I was just thinking through stuff, and I wasn't even feeling stressed or anything. I just was couldn't sleep. Probably had too much coffee, and so I was just laying there. And I started thinking through things and thinking about the church, and I'm one of those guys that kind of eats, drinks, sleeps ministry. Like, I love what I do. Like, I don't know, like, if you think, like, this up here is hard work for me, this is fun. Like, this is what I'd like to do every day. If you all would show up every day for 12 hours, we'd just do this, you know? But so, like, I love it, but I was just thinking about stuff, and I was thinking about things that people have said to me and promises that God has made me in my life. And it's hard sometimes when you think of promises that God makes, but the reality you're living in is not that, right? God promised you that your kid would be okay, and right now doesn't feel like they are, right? God promised you that you would see the next generation serving God, and it feels like all they're doing is just living as far away from God as they can get. Maybe God promised you that you would be healed and you're still fighting the same addiction or the same disease. I don't know what it is for you, but I know that what God tells you will come to pass no matter what happens. And so I fell asleep and I had this dream, and I don't think it was like a prophetic dream, like, get ready, guys. Watch out, an airplane's coming through the window. No, I'm just kidding. Drink the Kool-Aid. Okay, so, no, not that. But I had this dream. And we were here. And it was a Tuesday, and we've been working on this prayer service. And this last Tuesday, we had people come in at noon, and at nighttime, we had a little interruption Tuesday night, but this bat came. That devil is a liar. Okay, this is really cool, though, because we were trying to catch the bat, and it was hilarious. Caleb had his, it went in the ceiling, right? You did catch it? You caught it Wednesday. Woo, air five. Thank you, because I don't come over here at night by myself. Okay, so he's, like, flying around. They're trying to catch him, and Wesley's in the balcony with a tablecloth, and Caleb's down here. It was quite hilarious. We're supposed to be praying, but I said, if that bat comes to my head, you ain't going to hear prayer. That's all I got to say. So at some point, jokingly, I was like, we've got to get this prayer service started. I was like, Lord, just get rid of the bat. And no lie, the thing went up into the ceiling, like, bye-bye. I was like, wow, that's cool. He never came back that night, so you caught him Wednesday. Thank you. I'm the only applause. Okay, cool. There he is. That ain't even funny. And so I have dreams in my heart for what I think this prayer service could look like. I'd love to see it open to the community in this auditorium packed with people coming in the midweek just praying for our community and praying for each other. And when there's six people in a bat, sometimes you're like, God, hello. And so I fell asleep and I had this dream, and in my dream it was a Tuesday night, and this place was just packed with people that were here to pray. And I woke up the next morning and I was like, what God said he'll do, he will do. I just have to stay faithful. I can't let the bat distract me, right? Because it'd be easy to say, hey, no more prayer, guys, because bats are here on Tuesday. Sunday mornings were good, but nighttime, we got bats, and so we're... No, we got to get a... I don't know what people do. How do you get a bat catcher? We get Batman, whatever it takes. Is Batman, is that... I don't know. But, like, we'll do what we have to do, because we got to pray, because God told me if we pray, the church would grow. And so if God said it, he will do it. But it's so easy to give up in the process and be like, well, I don't really know because it got hard and the bat showed up and this happened in my life. And you told me I was going to have a flourishing marriage and I got divorced and all these things. And so I don't know, God. I just don't know that you actually care. And he's like, hold on. Hold on. You're still in the pit. But you will get to the palace because what I tell you will come to pass. If you'll stand with me this morning. This verse will come up on the screen. I want to close with this verse. I've read it many times. I love it out of the Message translation. It's the Apostle Paul talking to the church at Corinth, and he says, Dear Corinthians, I can't tell you how much I long for you to enter this wide, open, spacious life. We didn't fence you in. The smallness you feel comes from within you. Your lives aren't small, but you're living them in a small way. I'm speaking as plainly as I can with great affection. Open up your lives. Live open and expansively. What are you going to do in the pit? Because the pit is preparing you for the palace. If you bow your heads and close your eyes all over this room. I wonder what your pit looks like. Some of you have decorated the pit, and you've got pictures hung and lamps sitting around, and it's pretty down here in the pit. And sometimes staying in the pit is easier than getting out and walking into that spacious life, because when you're in that CAT scan and you're stuck in that area where you're really claustrophobic, like, all that matters is you. And sometimes it's easier just to take care of me than it is to step out into a wide expanse of life that impacts the world and saves many. So I wonder what your pit looks like, even as you see it in your mind's eye as your eyes are closed. What that situation looks like in your life and where you have not been acting with integrity or character, or having the intention to keep praising God even when it's hard, or all the things that you know to be true if you study his word. Or maybe even a step beyond that, maybe you're in the pit and you've totally given up on God. Maybe you're in the pit and you're like, this Jesus thing, I don't think it works, because he said, and you quote the verse about the things that he said, and that's not what I'm seeing in my life. And so I'm just done. I want to encourage you this morning to keep surrendering to Christ while you're in the pit. Because you can build a ladder as much as you want, but it's going to fall down and conk you in the head. You're not the one that pulls you out of that place. He is. And the only way you're ever going to get out is by submitting your life to Him, choosing to trust in Him, choosing to hold on to Him when it's dark and you can't see, believing that He will pull you back into the light. And so if you're here this morning and you just say, I've never even surrendered my life to Christ. I've never given my life up for Jesus. I've never said, Jesus, I want to serve you. I want to lay down my own cause and live for your cause. Then I just want you to know, first and foremost here today, today could be your day to surrender your life to Christ. To say, God, I've tried to get out of this pit on my own so many times, and I cannot do it on my own. I need you in my life. I need your strength. I need your forgiveness for my sins. I need you to come in and to wash me fresh so I can see with a fresh perspective, so I can be who you've created me to be. And so if you're here today and you say, maybe it's the first time or it's some time that you've done it over and over and over and over in your life, and you just say, God, from the pit I'm in today, I just want to surrender my life one more time to Christ. Would you just raise your hand so I can pray for you? Thank you. Thank you for your boldness. You're in the pit, but you will not stay there. And how you'll come out is through Christ. And so, Father, this morning, I pray over every single person that raised their hand, God. Whether it's the first time they're surrendering to you or the 100th time, I pray, Holy Spirit, that you would be so kind to them this week. That you would help them to start undecorating the pit. That you'd help them to lay down the junk in their life that they've been turning to instead of turning to you as their source, God. That you'd help them to lay down addictions and get addicted to your word. That you'd help them to lay down wrong mindsets and start dwelling on what you say, whatever is true and whatever is pure and whatever is excellent and worthy and praiseworthy. If anything is praiseworthy, to think on those things. I pray that you would convict our minds in the pit, God. A very person who raised their hand, and even those who didn't, God, that you convict our minds when we're living from the pit, but acting like we're staying in it. Give us a great, big, wide, open perspective. Help us to come out of the narrow place and into the space that you've created us for, God, so we can impact the world around us, so we can live a flourishing life, so we can save many from our obedience, God. I pray that you would deliver us from the pit. And as we're there, that you would develop us into everything you need us to be. So when we get to the palace, we are equipped and ready to be the people you've called us to be. And I thank you for that in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Keep your hands together this morning and thank God for His word.